Hello, welcome to my introduction to pinmuxing and GPIO control under Linux talk for the Embedded Linux Conference 2021. I would have preferred to be in person in Seattle, but it's not possible, so let's keep it virtual maybe next year. So, first of all, we're going to start at a hardware level. To see what is a pin or a pad or what is a GPIO from an hardware point of view. So when you have your chip or your SoC, system on chip, you can have multiple ways, multiple package types. One common one is the QFP or equivalent to a QFN, which has all the pin or pads on the sides. And the other type of packages are the BGA ones, where the pad or pins are in fact balls underneath the package. And there's two different ways of soldering the SoC. So the BGA is much complex to solder. The QFN can be done by hand, for example, but you won't find a high profile SoC in QFP package. The really complex and high profile SoC are all in BGA because you can have much more pins and you can have them much better layout on the PCB, but more complex to design. So if you go further in the package, you see the die, which it's the part which is actually produced on wafers. So the die is put on a plastic, some small wires are soldered and connected to the external pins, you see. And afterwards, the plastic package is closed on top. So, is globally how it's done inside. It's not always like that, but it's a good example. So when now you see where are exactly the pads on the die. What's in the hardware design? What's in the hardware exactly? So it is a typical hardware design of a pad, where you have the physical point where the small wires are connected. Internally is connected to an analog IP, which is here to deal with all the analog parts. Like the voltage, the grounding, the pull-ups, pull-down, the triggers, meet, and so on. And afterwards, you have all the digital parts. You have, for example, a mux for the input of the output. For the input mux, it's not always here. Some SoCs connect the input to all the functions, for example. And for the output, there's always a mux with an output enabled. So it's not the output, so to say, for example, to put input or an output. And typically, the GPIO, so the general purpose input output, is one, generally one of the functions. Sometimes one of the default function or the fallback function, when no function are selected. So the GPIO is only a digital way to control the pad. The voltage, 1, 0, input, etc. So in the analog part, you see the typical analog part of a pad. We call it a push-pull pad or CMOS pad. It's a three-state pad. So the three states are the two, one, and 0 level, so 1 level is driven to the pad voltage, so VCC or VCC-IO. 0 is driven to ground, and There is a third state called high impedance when it's not driven by anyone. So no component on the PCB actually drive nothing on the line. This is why the high impedance has a special drawing to say it's between 0 and 1, but nobody knows what's the value in fact. So this is a push-pull pad where you can drive to 0 and to 1. Okay. For some special application, for example Y2C or one wire, you have some special pads called open drain pads. They can only drive to ground, only to 0. They cannot drive to 1. So it's either in input or in output, but to ground. So when you see the diagram underneath, so you can manage to have a one or zero on a bus, but you need a pull up on the PCB, and this pull up will actually pull the level to one when the SoC is in input. This is how I2C works, in fact. None of the I2C components, host or devices, never drive to one. They only drive to zero. The reverse is the open source pad. This one is really rarely used, but it exists. It's a reverse. The SoC cannot drive to ground, but only to VCC. So it can be used in some specific hardware, but it's rarely used. So, like I said, the analog pad hardware has optional components like a pull-up. They can add a small resistors on all pads to add a pull-up or a pull-down to ground or to VCC. You can select the drive frames, for example, to select the some buses need different drive trends, or some buses only require lower drive trends, so you can lower your consumption, and other possible analog stuff. So, the functions. Okay, so the input and the output can be mixed to a function. So usually you have an individual selection by pad. So each pad has a register when you can put a number, and the number identifies the function. This is not necessarily the case. Some order integers are weird, and you can have a group selection, for example, and you select the function. And when you select the function, all the pad of the function will trigger. So it's not always the case. And you can have, for example, pads that are only GPIO, with only one function. Pads without GPIO, with only functions. Function can that select all pads at one time. Or for example, one bit to select multiple pad for a function. So all this must be handled in software. So the software level. Did we have 10 or 12 years ago? So it was anarchy, complete anarchy. The ARM SoC were not really majority in Linux code base. So you had every vendor was really disparate. You didn't have the same support, for example. You had for some SoC, like router SoC or some simpler one, you had really a simple hard-coded pin setup, like a single function, like you say, set this pin to this function, really basic. To some really complex framework, for example in the Samsung SoC support or TI, with a really complex conflict checking code. And what we learn of that is actively checking the conflict is really complex, and you cannot check it. It's too complex. For example, you will need really to describe a lot of hardware to know what combination of pin is possible or not. And in fact, it's useless because if you do a good code review of the board support and testing, and you implement a simple check, it's enough. Voilà. We need the dynamic setup. For example, for low power device, when you go to suspend, for example, or runtime suspend, or sometimes like for complex buses like SDIO or NMC, you need to switch the pin config at runtime for specific modes. And we don't want hard coding of board setup at all. So this is why Dev-S3 is here, because it was like hell. So GPIO API was also an issue. It was older than pin control, and it was even worse. You didn't have a single GPIO.h. In each board or architecture support, you had a different GPIO header. So potentially you had a different API, different implementation, different types, different behavior. So it was completely saying the API was too basic. Every implementation was different. You couldn't handle multiple GPIO controllers. It was really complex. Impossible to handle nested controllers like I2C controllers, SPI controllers, extenders. And only some SoCs had advanced API with runtime CMPM support and so on. And GPIO-RQ was too simple and too SOC specific. So first of all, how did it change with the pin control framework? So it was like 10 years ago, in fact, nearly 10 years ago. It was merged in Linux 3.2. So it created the Linux pin control subsystem to handle pin control devices. Like I said in the other part, it controlled different aspects of package pins. So the main goal was to remove all the sparse, the different ARM arch implementation, and simplify everything to have a simple code base to implement the same thing in a sane manner. So thanks Linus Welsh for your work, and still because you're still maintaining the pin control. So the pin controller, it was split in different the pin controller, the pin mixing, the pin control. So the pin controller describes the hardware that control pins. That you can multiplex BIAS, load capacitance, drive sense for individual pins or group of pins. So, like you see, it was defined to cover all the possible use cases you find in the field. So, what is a pin? Like I said, in the hardware description, you can call it a pad, a finger, a ball, or whatever goes out of the package and you can control. Okay. So instead of using the same GPIO architecture where you have a single number across every controller, no, you have a number space in each controller. So there is no every pin won't have a single ID. You will have the pin controller handle and an ID in the controller. So it simplifies a lot the architecture because you can have a lot of pin controllers. Not only the SoC pin controllers, you can have multiple pin controllers and SoC, and you can have external pin controllers. Like for example, GPIO extender, some of them can be pin controllers. They can offer some feature on some pin. And one important, the pin space is not it maybe can make gaps in the space, because when you have for example a QFP package from 1 to 63, not all pins are controllable. You can have some voltage pin, you can have some analog pins and ground pins. So you must cover, you make sure if you have gaps, it's quite handed. So some controllers only work with group of pins. So it's a great part to handle. And finally, the pin muxing, which was in the main part of the framework, is selecting actinat functions, or some hardware calls them muxing modes, which permits to select functions on each pins. And a great feature of the framework is this can be changed at runtime, actually. So how the pins are described in the framework? You will see on the left you can have a list of pins. Here I use the two a letter and number, for example. So you can have the A pins, the B pins, the G pins. They're not complete, so you can have holes in it. You will define pin groups for example I2C or UART, every function groups, and for example you can have multiple function groups for similar, for example you can have a variant of UART with different groups. For example UART1 can be routed to multiple different group of pins, so you can handle this. For example, I defined four groups, one for I2C, one for UART, and the RTS and CTS pins on different groups, because for example, these are optional. And in the function list, I said, okay, I2C0 only has one group, but UART1 can have three groups. UART1, UART1 RTS, and UART1 CTS, because the three of them can be set, but only one. You can choose which groups of function can be set at runtime. So yeah. So instead of to have a kernel-wide number, you have a controller-wide number and names associated to everything: two pins, two groups, and two functions. It's simpler to associate everything via names than numbers. So a name must be unique. For pin groups, you can have multiple pins, one or more. For functions, you can have multiple pin groups. And the conflict checking is here. The core will store what are the functions set for each pin or for groups. So if you set a conflicting group, for example, it will be detected. So it's the simplest way to detect a conflict. The only thing it doesn't detect is when you set a function on a pin before Linux. The core doesn't handle, cannot load the state of the current pins. It's only a limitation. So the framework is pretty simple. For example, you have three structures to fill. First of all, the pin list. It's only a table of pin control pin desk, which has the name inside, and three ops, so pin control, pin muxing, and pin config. The pin control is pretty simple because it's only callbacks. You can really define your own table that really matches the hardware. And you will need to implement the callbacks to give the framework what you need. So the number of groups, the name of the groups, and the pin names of groups. So it's much simpler than feeding him tables. So you can compute, in fact, in these functions. So you can really describe the hardware like the vendor does. And in these functions, you can compute and give to the framework some processed information. So this is for the groups, and same for the function. The function which associates the different groups to a function. So you have the count, the name, which groups, and the final call simply sets a function in a group. A group in a function. So it's the setMux is the main call, in fact. When all the calls have been called by the core, and when the SoC support and the driver probes, the driver will ask to set the default pinmux, and the core will process all the data and call setmux to set a function on different groups. So it was designed before Device 3, but finally, even it was before, the mapping in DT works really well, and the usage didn't change at all. In fact, it's the same way to set a pin control. So the code I list here, so the pin control get, lookup state, and select state, now is called by the core. So when you probe a device, automatically this will be done, in fact, under the hood. So you don't need to do anything to set up pin control. Only set the right properties in DT or STPI to actually define what are the needed groups and functions for the particular device, and it will be done by default. So initially, it will set the init or default state, but you can have some special port management state, in fact, which are here to handle all the runtime PM states to lower consumption. So here is the DT, the way how it's defined DT. So the first node is a subnode of the pin controller node. So for example, for the pins I defined earlier, if you want to define the UART1 pins, you simply need to have a node, a subnode of this one. You can have multiple nodes. Here I have a single MUX subnode, but in a single in a DT mapping node, you can set up a lot of different groups and functions. Here I only set one, for example. I set the three groups, so UART1, UART1 RTS, and UART1 CTS, and I say this should be to the UART function, because groups can be in multiple functions. So here it's in one function, but I could have set different groups in a different function. So. And in the device node of the UART controller, for example, you simply put a P handle to the UART1 DT mapping in the default node name, and automatically at the probe, the UART1 pin will be set. This is like magic, but it works really well. So now comes to the GPIO framework. So the GPIO framework is here to handle the general purpose IO. So it's the specific function of pins that can be controlled by software. So you can set at input pod and output 1 and 0 and other optional features. So the deep IO provider infrastructure, which defines a single deep IO.h, was submitted in 2008, so for 2.6.25. So it provides an infrastructure that make a single programming interface. So this programming interface is still almost valid today because it defined finally an unified API and implementation. So it was named JPIO lib. So it was more designed like a library than a modern framework. Every JPIO on the system, so on the board, not only the SOC, but also on external JPIO controllers, you had an unique kernel-wide number for each JPIO. So you need to hack to know what was the right JPIO number to be used by Java. So it was okay in 2008 when you had like 20 JPIOs, but in nowadays as aussi like the Tegra ones, when you can have we can have 200 JPIOs in 20 controllers, it's much more complex and it will be nearly unimplementable at the time. So the stacking numbering was really made it really limited. So it was replaced in the time by the new implementation called JPIO-D. So JPIO-D, it's named like this for JPIO descriptor. This new framework use a descriptor for each JPIO pin. In fact, instead of you still have an unique number, but this unique number is not the main processing component of the framework. The framework works with a JPIO desk. So you can have a correspondence between a number and a JPIO desk, but internally it uses only JPIO desk. So the consumer now only knows JPIO desk, for example, and not a number. But you still have compatibility with the legacy interface with numbers, but it's not the main. The main idea that drives the framework anymore. So you can still leave use the legacy API, even if Linux Wallage removes some feature at every release. But now you have a directory with, for example, consumer.h, which are designed only for drivers. So drivers should only use consumer.h, which is the same as pin control, in fact. Pin control has the same split between the consumer functions and the driver and system functions. So you have driver.h that is only for JPIO controller drivers, and consumer.h which are for the consumers, for the other drivers that need JPIOs to make all the feature. For example, driver.h. Here's an example how you register a new controller. So basically, it will need a name, for example. But the main callbacks of the controller are direction output, get, and set. With three functions, you have the main callbacks of the controller. So the core we call direction output. When an input, when an output mode is requested, get value when the driver or the consumer wants to get the actual value on the pad, and set to set an output value. And the other are base. Base is a legacy because in the time when you didn't have a proper framework, you needed to say at which what was the start number of your controller. For example, for the main controller it was 0, for the external controller it was 100 and 400 and so on. With the new framework, you can still set your base for legacy implementations, but for new modern implementations, you set minus one, saying put me anywhere because we don't need to have a fixed number for GPIOs. And number GPIO for to say what are the number of GPIOs on the system. And finally, GPIO chip add data, which will register the device to the framework. On the other side, you have the consumer.h, and I will only show how it's linked with device tree, but with ICPI it's globally the same, but for ICPI. So for example, let's look to a simple audio amplifier, which is the most basic node, which only has a GPIO to enable the amplifier. So if you look at the node, you have first of all the name of the attribute, which is enable GPIOs. So the enable is the function name of the GPIO. And you can have multiple GPIO. For example, the most used names are reset GPIOs, shutdown GPIOs, but you need to respect the function name GPIO with S. This is the new bindings you must use. And in the attribute, you have, for this example, first of all, the handle of the GPIO controller. Secondly, a number that defines the offset it is completely controller or platform specific. Here it's for MLogic SoC, so we have a DT bindings header that defines this one. But for example, with some very complex SoCs, we have a macro where you set which bank and which position on the package you have the pin. And finally, the third one is GPIO flags. So what are GPIO flags? So the GPIO flags, they express what are the characteristics of the GPIO on the system and on the how it's interconnected on the board. For example, the bit zero will express what is the actual polarity of the GPIO. When at which level the function is active. For example, for reset, often it will be active low. So for reset, active low. For enable, for example, enable it's active high. So you put active high. And you have other defines for push-pull, which is default, open source, open drain, like we saw on the hardware description. You have an other specific option for suspend resume and pull-up pull-downs. Pull-up pull-downs can be set either in GPIO, often it's done in the pin controller, in fact. So on the consumer side, the driver only need to do two calls to use a GPIO. So for example, simply GPIO get with the name of the GPIO, like here enable, the name of the function, and an optional flag which says how the GPIO must be initialized. So here we want the enable, but we want it to be default to low. So for example, we want it to be disabled as probe of the device, and later we will set the value. So set value 0 or 1. So the DT flags will invert automatically the polarity, for example. If you set GPIO active low, for example, and you do GPIO set 1, the framework will set the GPIO to 0, in fact. This must be taken in account when you write the DD bindings and the driver. You must know how you want the GPIO to be defined, as you want the active polarity to be taken in account or not. So, for example, for active low, if you pass 0 to set value, it will be set to set 1 and 0 in the reverse. So, the term relationship with pin control and GPIO, pin control was designed to take in account GPIO. In fact, you can link the pin controller to the GPIO controller. Because in fact, in some SoCs, you have a common hardware for pin controlling and GPIO. So often you will need to we have a single driver in fact for both. It's not a problem. It's designed like that. So and on other design, you have a different IP for pin control and GPIO. So you can specify what ranges of pin controller are handled by the GPIO controller. So for example, you can have a single pin controller for the whole SoC, but different GPIO controllers, for example. And in DT or in the driver, you can say, okay, pin 0 to 10, it's this GPIO controller, pin 11 to 20, this GPIO controller. So everything it will go through the pin controller API when you request a GPIO, for example, it will request the mode, the GPIO mode in the pin controller. This is really handy, in fact. So thank you for listening for this introduction. You can scan the QR code for the slide, and I'll be happy to answer to all your questions in the chat.